गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. टुडे वी विल बी सीइंग अबाउट लैब डायग्नोसिस ऑफ वायरल इन्फेक्शंस. सो व्हाई दिस डायग्नोसिस ऑफ वायरस इन्फेक्शंस इज मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट और इट्स बिकमिंग मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट नाउअडेज, बिकॉज एज द वायरसेस एंड देयर इन्फेक्शंस आर नाउ इमर्जिंग एंड री इमर्जिंग एंड दे आर कॉजिंग मेनी डिजीजेस इन द ह्यूमंस दैन द प्रीवियस डिकेड्स. सो दिस डायग्नोसिस ऑफ वायरस इन्फेक्शन इज मच मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट नाउ. So, in addition to that, why it is important to diagnose a viral disease? One is, you can screen a viral infection, whether it can be in blood donors, pregnant women, elderly people, or in TB patients. Like, for example, in pregnant women, if a rubella is diagnosed in the first trimester of pregnancy, then abortion is recommended. Then also, if a newborn is diagnosed to have hepatitis B infection, then immunoglobulins can be started or should be started within 12 hours of birth. So lab diagnosis is very important for screening of viral infection. And apart from this, for diagnosis of etiological agent of viral infection, for instituting proper antiviral therapy, like for example HIV, herpetic encephalitis, okay. And other than that, for detection and prediction of etiological agent of epidemics or even pandemics also. Then identification of antigenic variation of virus, which helps in vaccine preparation and also control of outbreaks and helps in suspecting a new viral infection. And in addition to all this, it is also important to start the post-exposure prophylaxis of antiretroviral drugs to the healthcare workers. Suppose in the hospitals, if the healthcare workers have needle stick injury, and it is very important to start the post-exposure prophylaxis. So, lab diagnosis of viral infections is very much important. So, for the diagnosis of viral infection, you have to follow certain precautions, like there should be a proper sample collection from the proper site at the proper time, and the quantity should be proper, and the method, mode of collection of the sample, it should be proper or accurate. And after collection, transportation, it is very very important, transportation of the samples. So for transportation, we use normally widely used media is viral transport media. Actually, this contains protein, antibiotic, pH indicator, and it is not required for sterile body fluids or CSF, as they cannot be diluted. So, what is this VTM? We'll see in future further slides. And the preservation, it should be up to 72 hours, but some bacteria, they survive in the transport media for more than 72 hours. And repeated freezing and thawing should be avoided. And proper test has to be initiated. We should know what test should be done in what condition. And the proper method of test is also very important. So, while collecting swabs, Dacron, rayon or nylon swabs are used. Why? Because they are dry swabs. Whereas this calcium alginate, cotton swabs or wooden stick swabs are not to be used because they are toxic, mostly for the enveloped viruses. So only Dacron, rayon or nylon swabs are used. And sample collected with these swabs like calcium alginate, cotton swabs or wooden sticks, even with other swabs also, these samples actually they are not suitable for PCR or DFAT or enzyme immunoassay. And wooden shafted swabs, they are not recommended for culture because they contain toxins and formaldehyde. So what are the specimens to be collected if we are suspecting viral infections? Suppose it is a respiratory tract infection causing some viral disease, then you go for nasal and bronchial washings, throat and nasal swabs or sputum. Suppose eye infections, you collect conjunctival swab or scraping, even corneal swab, then throat sample also you can take. For GIT infections, stool and rectal swabs. For any rashes, be it vesicular rash or maculopapular rash, we take the fluid, that is vesicle fluid, skin scrapings, or throat stool and throat swab stool and rectal swabs. Suppose any CNS infections like encephalitis and meningitis, you can take stool, tissue, saliva, brain biopsy and cerebrospinal fluid. If we are suspecting any genital infections, then again swab has to be taken. For UTI, urine sample, and for bloodborne infections, blood has to be taken. So after taking out, after collection of the specimens, like more particularly swab, they have to be transported in the viral transport medium. So ideally this viral transport medium, it should have most importantly better preservation of the viruses, and it should be suitable for all tests, and it should have long shelf life, and it should be inexpensive and also readily available. So ideal VTM, that is a viral transport medium, should have better preservation of viruses, readily available, inexpensive, long shelf life, and it should be suitable for doing all tests. And this viral transport medium, it contains these ingredients or whatever you call contents. Salt solution. Why salt solution is there? Because it maintains proper ionic concentrations, and the buffer, it maintains pH. It also contains protein for virus stability. And antibiotics or antifungals are also there in this VTM to prevent the growth of bacteria or fungus, or to prevent any contamination. And there are few studies on virus stability which show that most viruses tested are sufficiently stable in the transport media to withstand the transport time of up to 72 hours, as I already said. But some viruses, they may withstand even longer transport times. So in many cases, actually it is not necessary to store virus specimens in the refrigerator or send them to lab on wet ice or frozen on dry ice. However, you should keep in mind that the specimen, it should not be exposed to environmental extremes. And this modern VTM, it allows for more effective use of viral culture and culture enhancement techniques, which indirectly is used for diagnosis of human viral infections. So coming to the diagnosis part, first is direct detection. It can be done by microscopy. Among all the microscopies, electron microscopy is the best one. Here what will happen, these specimens, whatever you are collecting, they are negatively stained by potassium phosphotungstate and scanned under electron microscopy. I am not going into the detail because it has already been dealt in general, that is general bacteriology, about this electron microscopy. So the basis of this is specimens are negatively stained by potassium phosphotungstate and scanned under electron microscopy. So what are the uses of this electron microscopy pertaining to this diagnosis of viral infection? One is to detect the shape of the viruses. That is, viruses can be identified based on the shape. Like if you see bullet shaped virus, you can name it as rabies. Wheel shaped is rotavirus. Coronavirus is petal shaped. They show petal shaped papillomas. Whereas space vehicle shaped is space vehicle shaped appearance is seen in adenovirus. Star shaped in astrovirus. Apart from this use, we have few other uses of electron microscopy, like direct detection from the specimens. For the viruses which are difficult to cultivate, this electron microscopy can be used. And as an alternative to tissue culture, okay? So virus can be also be detected from the tissue culture. But the most important drawback is it is highly expensive. It is highly costly and it has low sensitivity, because it has detection limit of at least 10 power 7 virions. Virions is complete infectious particle. So at least 10 power 7 virions per ml should be present in the specimen. So it has very low sensitivity, and the specificity is also low. So apart from electron microscopy, you can also see by immunoelectron microscopy. Here what is in addition to electron microscopy, here specific antibody is added to the specimen, because so that the virus particles are aggregated and which can be centrifuged and easily observed under the microscopy. Okay, this is about immunoelectron microscopy. So when compared to electron microscopy, the sensitivity and specificity are little bit higher when about this immunoelectron microscopy. Then coming to fluorescent microscopy, again I am not going into the detail, okay, of this microscopy, fluorescent microscopy. It has already been dealt in immunology. So fluorescent microscopy, here direct immunofluorescence technique is used to detect the viral particles, and the uses are to detect or to diagnosis of rabies in skin biopsies or corneal smears of the infected patients, and also detection of adenovirus from the conjunctival smears. In addition to these, you can also have rapid diagnosis of respiratory infections which are caused by influenza virus, respiratory syncytial virus, adenovirus, rhinoviruses and herpes viruses, which can be carried out by adding specific antibodies to each of these viruses. So in short, you can see fluorescence pattern. Okay, so till now we have seen electron microscopy, immunoelectron microscopy, fluorescent microscopy, and one more microscopy, light microscopy. Here light microscopy, as such we cannot detect viruses, so some modification to the staining has to be done to see the virus under the light microscope. So first is HP, histopathological staining. It is used for detection of inclusion bodies, like example Negri bodies. So Negri bodies, they can be detected in brain biopsies of the patients or animals who have died of rabies. And other than HP staining, you can also do immunoperoxidase staining. Here the cells or the tissue sections, whatever you are taking, these are coated with viral antigens and are stained using antibodies which are tagged with horseradish peroxidase, and then hydrogen peroxide is added as a coloring agent, or even benzidine derivative can also be added. Then you can see a colored complex formed, which can be viewed under the light microscopy. So this is about direct detection by microscopy. So one is electron microscopy, immunoelectron microscopy, fluorescent microscopy, and light microscopy. Then coming to the detection of viral antigens. So again, these methods, so various formats are available for the detection of viral antigens in any sample, like serum, stool, okay. So various formats like ELISA, immunochromatographic test, or flow through assays, etc., are available. Again, these all methods are dealt in detail in immunology. So as of now, just remember this antigen detection test, where are they useful? Like hepatitis B surface antigen and HBe antigen detection for diagnosing hepatitis B infection from the serum, whereas NS1 antigen detection for dengue virus infection from again serum. Then P24 antigen detection, it is for HIV virus infection from the serum, whereas rotavirus antigen detection from diarrheic stool. And CMV specific PP65 antigen detection, here serum sample can be selected. So this is about detection of viral antigen. Then coming to detection of viral antibodies, there are very conventional diagnostic techniques also, but these are less commonly used nowadays when compared to newer methods like ELISA, ICT or flow through assays. Okay, but earlier when they were used much abundantly, like for example in heterophile agglutination test, which we used to do for Paul Bunnell test for detecting Epstein-Barr virus, whereas heme agglutination inhibition test is for influenza virus and arbovirus infections, and neutralization test for polio virus and again for arbovirus infections. Then complement fixation test for detecting polio virus, arbovirus and rabies virus infections. So these are less commonly used nowadays, but mostly this ELISA, this ICT, immunochromatographic techniques and flow through SS are used abundantly nowadays. For example, in detecting anti-HBC, anti-HBS and anti-HBE antibodies for hepatitis B infections and anti-hepatitis C antibodies, then antibodies against HIV 1 and 2 antigens in serum, and again anti-dengue IgM, IgG antibodies, okay. So this is in brief about detection of viral antibodies. Then coming to the molecular methods, these are more sensitive, more specific, and they yield results much rapid than the cultures which are available. So one is nucleic acid probe. So here enzyme or radiolabeled nucleic acid sequence, which is complementary to the part of nucleic acid sequence of a virus. Okay. Then when this complex is added to the clinical specimen, it hybridizes to the corresponding part of the viral nucleic acid. So depending on the type of label which we are using, which is attached to the probe, the hybridized label probe can be subsequently detected by the colorimetric methods, because it produces the color, which is detected by dot blot hybridization. Okay. Dot blot hybridization or gamma counting. So they are readily available, both the DNA probes and also RNA probes. Nucleic acid probes, are they better than PCR? No, because they have low sensitivity when compared to PCR, as it directly detects the viral genes in the specimen without amplification, whereas in PCR we do amplification. So coming to PCR, this PCR and reverse transcriptase PCR, it has already been dealt, but for quantifying, real time PCR is important. Why? Because PCR and reverse transcriptase PCR, they cannot quantify the viral nucleic acid load in the specimen. So for quantifying the viral nucleic acid, real-time PCR has been developed. These real-time PCR, it is used to monitor the treatment response, like for monitoring the response to any antiretroviral drugs, and it has less time as the amplification is visualized on the real-time basis. So this is about the molecular methods. Still now we have seen detection, direct detection by microscopy, that is electron microscopy, immunoelectron microscopy, fluorescence and light microscopy. Then detection of viral antigens, detection of viral antibodies, then molecular methods. Now coming to the cultivation of the viruses. As we already know, viruses cannot be grown on artificial culture medium, because being most technically demanding, technically challenging and more time consuming, this virus isolation, it is routinely not done in diagnostic side. Okay, so this cultivation will be running under these three headings: animal inoculation, embryonated eggs and tissue culture. Under tissue culture, we have organ culture, explant culture and cell culture. All the above are obsolete except this cell culture. Why? We'll see now. But though they are obsolete, we'll see few points about each of this. Okay, first is animal inoculation. So here some animals like mice, infant suckling mice, rats, monkeys, guinea pigs, rabbits, ferrets, they are used for inoculation. And the growth of virus, they may be indicated either by death, disease or visible lesions in the animals. So the use of this animal inoculation is for the study of pathogenesis of any viral infections, for immune response study, epidemiology and oncogenesis. And the disadvantage is the immunity, they may interfere with the viral growth. The immunity of the animal, they may interfere with the viral growth. And that animals often, they harbor the latent viruses in them. And because of the ethical issues related to the use of animals, this animal inoculation is largely used only for research purpose. So this is about animal inoculation. Then coming to egg inoculation. Here, embryonated hen's eggs, that too, embryonated 7 to 12 days old eggs are used for cultivation of the viruses. This concept was first done by Goodpasture in 1931, and this concept it was further developed by Burnett. Okay, so what will happen? The specimens, they can be inoculated by 4 different routes into the egg and then incubated for 2 to 9 days. And this, remember this, the embryonated hen's egg should be embryonated 7 to 12 days old. So what are these 4 routes? One is chorioallantoic membrane inoculation, and one is amniotic inoculation, the third one is yolk sac inoculation, and the fourth is allantoic inoculation. So chorioallantoic membrane inoculation, it is mostly done for herpes simplex virus, pox virus or sarcoma virus, whereas amniotic inoculation, it is done for influenza virus and mumps virus. Yolk sac inoculation for herpes simplex virus, allantoic for influenza, mumps, Newcastle disease virus or avian adenovirus. So this is about egg inoculation. So in cultivation of viruses, we have seen animal inoculation and egg inoculation. And the third one is tissue culture. So in this tissue culture, we have already seen, we have 3 types. One is organ culture, explant culture and the cell line culture. So we will be seeing very few points about these two, that is organ culture or explant culture, that is tissue culture, and in detail about the cell line culture. So first coming to organ culture, here what will happen after isolating an organ, small bits of the organs are taken and they can be maintained in vitro for days and weeks, but their original structure and function has to be maintained. So this organ culture, it is used for isolation of some viruses which appear to be highly specialized parasites of certain organs. Means some viruses, they grow only in few organs. Like for example, if you take coronavirus, which is a respiratory pathogen, it grows only in certain organs like tracheal ring. Okay, so it grows only in tracheal ring. So organ culture, example you can give tracheal ring culture, which is used for growing coronavirus. Then coming to explant or tissue culture, here fragments of tissue which are minced, they can be grown as explants, and these are embedded in the plasma clots or they may be cultivated in some suspension. Okay, example adenoid tissue explants can be taken for growing adenoviruses. Okay, so this is about organ culture and explant culture, that is tissue culture. Now coming to third type of culture, that is cell line culture. So what is cell culture? First remember this, cell culture is nothing but it is a process of removing cells from an animal or plant and subsequent growth in the artificially controlled environment. So what is the cell line culture? It is a process of removing cells from either animal or plant and subsequent growth in an artificially controlled environment. So what will happen, from the organ we have taken tissue, and from the tissue how we will get the cells? By tissue digestion. When this tissue is digested, it can be either by proteolytic enzymes like trypsin or collagenase, which is followed by mechanical shaking, we get the cells. So what will happen after getting the cells? These cells are washed, then counted and suspended in the viral growth medium again, I said this viral growth medium has characteristics similar to viral transport medium. So this viral growth medium contains balanced salt solution. It has essential amino acids and vitamins, salts and glucose, which is supplemented by 5 to 10% of the fetal calf serum and antibiotics. And it has pH indicator as phenol red, and the pH has to be maintained around 7.2 to 7.4. So after cells are washed, counted, and when they are suspended into the viral culture medium. So viral culture medium has all the following components which we discussed just now. Then these tissue culture flasks, they are incubated horizontally, that too in the presence of carbon dioxide, either as stationary culture or roller drum culture. Why? Because rolling of this culture bottle, it provides better aeration. Why do we need better aeration for the virus to grow? Because there will be some fastidious viruses, example rotavirus. So for isolation of these rotavirus, for isolation of this fastidious virus, we require aeration. So to provide this better aeration, rolling of the culture tube is done. So based on so again these cell lines, they are categorized into three types. One is primary cell culture, secondary or diploid cell culture, which is semi-continuous cell culture, and the third one is continuous cell culture. So what is the main difference? And these cell line cultures, they are categorized based on the origin, chromosomal characters, number of generations through which they are maintained. Okay, according to this, they are classified into three types. But the main difference between this primary cell culture and the secondary cultures are, this primary cell culture, they are obtained directly from a plant or animal tissue. While this secondary or diploid cell cultures, these are obtained from primary cell culture, from an established primary culture. Therefore, this secondary culture, it is a new culture which has originated from the primary culture. Here the cells are taken directly from an animal or any plant tissue. Okay. So, few points about each of this. Primary cell culture. So, this is used, as I already said, it is a process to be used for culture cells from the plant tissue or animal tissue directly. So, these cells in the primary culture, they have an finite, that is definite lifespan, because they might have already exhausted the substrates and nutrients present in them. Okay, so primary culture, despite the separation techniques which were used in the isolation process, they may contain several types of cells. Okay, and they have very limited growth, and the divisions are, they take about only 5 to 10 divisions, and they maintain diploid karyosome. So uses is for primary isolation and for vaccine production. Examples like human kidney cell line and human amnion cell line are used. Okay, this is about primary cell line. Whereas secondary cell line, usually these secondary cell lines, as I already said, the cells in these are obtained from the primary culture. So this secondary cell culture, it gives the opportunity for expanding the cell population, and also to prolong the lifespan, and also it helps in further selection of the cells, because in primary cell line we had wide, it may contain several types of cells. So in this, it may give chance to select further, give us chance to further select few cells with the use of some selective medias. And it allows genotypic and also phenotypic uniformity in the population. So it is said that the secondary cell line culture, it is used to generate replicate cultures for better preservation and for experimentation. So again, the divisions it occurs, it takes is around 10 to 50 divisions, and it maintains diploid karyosome, uses same like primary cell line, that is primary isolation and vaccine production. Examples, like human fibroblast cell line in cytomegalovirus, MRC5, WI38, MMR and rabies vaccine. So whenever we are taking a virus in detail, we will see about all this. Then the third one is about continuous cell line. So this continuous cell line, as the name itself suggests, they can be serially cultivated and that too indefinitely. Okay. So this standard continuous cell lines, they have been derived from human cancer cells, such as HeLa cells, from the human carcinoma of cervix cell line, or HEP2 cells, that is human epithelioma of larynx cell line, then Vero from the velvet monkey kidney cell line, then KB from the KB cancer cell, that is from the human carcinoma of nasopharynx cell line, then McCoy from human synovial carcinoma cell line, BHK21, that is baby hamster kidney cell line. Okay, so these are most widely used. These continuous cell lines are most widely used, and this continuous cell line is otherwise also known as heteroploid cultures. Heteroploid cultures. Okay. Then coming to the detection of the viral growth in the cell culture. So in the cell cultures, how do you detect the viral growth? One is by cytopathic effect. What is cytopathic effect? It is a morphological change produced by the virus in the cell line, which is detected by the light microscope. Example here, you can see the cell rounding or syncytium formation. Syncytium formation is mostly seen in few viruses like measles, RSV, respiratory syncytial virus, or herpes simplex virus. Whereas rapid crenation and degeneration of the entire cell is seen in enteroviruses. So these are few types of cytopathic effects. That is the morphological change which are produced by the virus in the cell line. And diffuse rounding and ballooning of the cell line is seen in HSV, cytoplasmic vacuolations in SV40, or large granular clumps which resemble bunches of grapes are seen in adenovirus. So if we take this as to be a normal cell, and this is the cytopathic effect, that is the morphological change seen. So here you can see a cytoplasmic inclusion body which is caused by rabies virus in the brain tissue, and it is a syncytium which is produced by the fusion of the cells in the measles virus. Then so detection of viral growth in cell cultures, one you can see by cytopathic effect, and the other is by viral interference. It has already been done, but few points about this. The growth of the first virus would inhibit the infection caused by the second virus. Okay, this forms the basis of interference. For example, rubella, which is a non-CPE virus, it prevents the replication of enterovirus, which are known to produce CPE. So the other thing is viral interference. And the third one is metabolic inhibition. When the viruses grow in cell cultures, their cell metabolism is inhibited and there is no acid production. So in this way, viruses can be detected. And the other method is by heme adsorption. Heme adsorption is nothing but process of adsorption of the erythrocytes to the surface of infected cells. So when hemagglutinating viruses, they grow in the cell culture, their presence can be detected by the addition of this guinea pig erythrocytes to the cultures. So here in this figure, you can see that at the titer of 32, you can see the process of heme adsorption, that is the process of adsorption of erythrocytes to the infected cells. You can see a uniform adsorption of the erythrocyte. So the titer in this figure is around 32 units. Okay. And the other example, in this figure you can see actually 7 different samples of influenza viruses are taken, and they were serially diluted with the chicken red blood cells, and they are incubated for 1 to 2 hours. And this bottom row, it contains no viruses. So agglutinated RBCs, what will happen? They coat evenly in the cells. Whereas non-agglutinated one, they form a distinct button at the bottom of the bell. So in the last seventh row, at which titer is it showing hemagglutination? That is at 1024. That means agglutinated RBCs are coated very well. Okay, coated in the well very well. Okay, so the titer in the seventh row is it around 1024, whereas in sixth it is around 64. So the titer is 64, and in fifth it is around 256. Okay, similarly observe in fourth, third, and second, and also first. So this is about heme agglutination. And the other thing is about transformation. Here oncogenic viruses, they induce transformation and loss of contact inhibition, so that the growth appears in piled up fashion, which produces micro tumors. Again, this viral growth can be seen by the direct microscopy, which can include either immunofluorescence microscopy, electron microscopy, the microscopies, and the viral gene detection by the PCR or molecular methods like the probes. Then coming to viral assays. So what do you mean by viral assay? Viral assay means determination of number of virus particles per unit volume of a sample. So you have few physical methods and biological methods. So physical methods, it estimate the total virus count, and physical method cannot distinguish between infectious and non-infectious virus particles. Whereas biological methods, it detects the infectious virions. Whereas physical methods, it cannot distinguish, like real-time PCR, antigen detection assay, hemagglutination assay, and electron microscopy. So coming to the biological methods, again it is divided into qualitative assay and quantitative assay. In qualitative assay, we have endpoint biological assay, whereas quantitative assay, plaque assay, and POC assay. So one point about each. Okay, endpoint biological assays, here it is the highest dilution of the virus which produces effect in 50% of the cells or animals inoculated, and the titer is expressed as 50% infectious dose, and it depends on the measurement of the animal death or the lesion or the cytopathic effects when serial dilutions of the viral suspension are inoculated in the animal cell. For example, here in this figure, 5 replicate wells of the cells are infected with 1 ml of each of 4 different virus dilutions. Okay, 4 different viral dilutions, they are incubated and scored for infection by looking at the CPE. So what is this endpoint biological assay here, where the animals, where the dilution, where it shows, where it produces the effect in which more than 50% of cells are affected. So the titer is around 10^6. Okay, so in precisely in this figure, they have calculated to 10^6.3, because here it is showing, because here why 10^6, because more than 50% of the cells or animals which have inoculated have produced the effect. So coming to plaque assay, it is most widely used assay for quantifying infectious viruses. Okay, so what is a plaque? Means multiple cycles of replication and cell killing, they produce a small area of infection called as plaque or plaque. Okay, here the titer is 10^7, because at this titer it shows plaque, okay, plaque. Okay, very few quantities of plaque. Then coming to plaque counting. So a single plaque arises from a single infectious virus particle. Hence the number of plaques counted will represent the number of, will represent the infectivity titer of the virus particle suspended. And coming to POC assay, here the number of POCs on chorionic membrane, they represent the approximate number of virus particles or infective viruses present in the dilution. So few viruses like variola, vaccinia, or herpes viruses, they form POCs on the POCs, POCs on the CAM, that is chorioallantoic membrane of the embryonated eggs. So in this way we can calculate the number of infective viruses present. So this is the ending of lab diagnosis of viral infection. So a small exercise, match the correct option. So for electron microscopy, which is the correct one? For one, which is the correct one? For electron microscopy, here the specimens are stained with phosphotungstate, okay? And for light microscopy, histopathological staining. And for real-time PCR, quantification of viral nucleic acid, ELISA. It is used both for antigen detection and viral detection. And this is a small homework for you. Please everybody answer this. Okay, so for heme agglutination inhibition test is done for influenza virus. So one, this is the correct option. And heterophil agglutination test, Paul Bunnell test, is an example for detecting Epstein-Barr virus. And rapid crenation of the cell, for these are cytopathic effects. These are cytopathic effects, and the virus is shown. Virus which exhibit this effect is enterovirus. And multinucleated germ cell formation or syncytial formation is seen in measles. And diffuse rounding of cell line, we see for herpes simplex virus. Okay, that's all. We end with this. Thank you.